Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us on World Awakening. In case you missed my previous show, Soul School, look at those dogs. I mean, oh my God, look how cute they are. They're so cute. They're joining us tonight. They're not co-hosting or doing anything other than napping. The show that I just finished was about life and lessons about death and the value and the beauty of loving and treasuring your loved ones and treasuring every moment that you have together. And so for those of you out there who are caregivers, who know the sacrifices, but also the beauty of caring for someone, especially a mother, someone who actually gave you life, I would encourage you to go back and look at the archive and hope that it is uplifting and that it brings some light into the darkness for you. That said, a few minutes before it was time to hop into Soul School, and you know I do the shows back to back on Friday nights, I got a message from my guest that he was indisposed. A family crisis had arisen and he was not available to come on. So what do I do? I said, Christine, my sister, Christine, call Erin, tell her she's going to be on a World Awakening tonight. Don't ask her, just tell her she's going to be on tonight. She's my girl Friday, just ready to hop right in. And so without further ado, let me welcome Erin Bush to the show.
Hi.
Hi, darling. Hi.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good. It's good to see you.
You too. Absolutely. You too. I never even really acknowledged you on Valentine's Day. I think I sent you the meme card about Violet and Peggy and Peggy being a whore. I think that's all that yes. I managed
that's
to.
That's all you needed to send.
You know.
We don't celebrate it anyway. So,
yeah. Oh my God, he made it.
Oh my goodness. What happened?
Oh, that's yes! So wonderful. I was just explaining to our viewers that you were not going to be able to join us. Erin, just stay.
No, y'all have fun. I'm going to go back to my couch. Oh, you want me to stay? Okay.
The reason that Tom is even on the show is because you were so taken with him that you recommended him for the show. And the thing that, ladies and gentlemen, Bill, you're not going to have to change anything in the archive because voila. the thing that's so interesting about it is that Erin and Tom met each other. And when she told him about me, he had no idea who I was, which I find incredibly refreshing. And I had no idea who he was, which he found, absolutely plausible because he keeps such a low profile in the field that it would stand to reason that I had not known him. But he and I talked, what was it, Tom, yesterday?
Yesterday.
We talked for about a half an hour.
Yeah, about that. Maybe a little longer. Yeah.
So it all is well. Erin is here, and she knows way more about you than I do, although I'm learning, and I read your bio three times because it took me three times to just absorb
it.
I'm
going to be on
your show. Yeah, I'm gonna go on your show in March.
Right.
So that's wonderful. So take a few minutes and tell our viewers who you are and what you do, and then we'll let the party begin.
Hi, everybody. My name is Tom Springer. Hi, Erin. Hi, Andrea. Great seeing you. I'm happy I made it here tonight. Nikki's doing well, by the way.
Good.
But as I stated, my name's Tom Springer, and I am the host of a show called Stuff I Never Learned from a School Book. The title came about because I am a very new awakening a couple years ago. Don't let the gray fool you. It's a new awakening. And but the beard is very nice, I must say.
Beard game is strong.
It's looking good on camera too. So but I didn't have a place really to reach out to others to find out about my abilities or to try to hone my abilities or do anything else. So I went ahead and created a site called Stuff I Never Learned from a School Book, where others like me can come and join in the community and we can talk to each other and go, all right, how can we mess this up completely, but get to blame each other for it as it happens?
Sure.
So it started out as a relatively small community. It still is a relatively small community, but it really is a family. And from there, it has kind of taken off to where I've had people on who are more veteran, who can help give us guidance and tell us, no, stop doing that. Stupid. You're doing it wrong. This is the way you're supposed to do it. And then someone else will go, no, don't listen to them because they don't know what they're doing.
They don't know what they're talking about. Do it my way. Do what I do. Do what I say. Yeah.
Exactly. Right. Yes. And then I started working on sensible people like Aaron. And so it went a whole different
direction after
that tells you
scary thought.
I'm just telling you, there's a level of people right there. It's kind of grown into more of a kind of a catch-all for what other people would call weird, odd, abnormal, because it really is now paranormal, cryptid, UFO, alien, spiritual healers, metaphysics, time travel, multiverses, dimensions, anything else that we want to talk about, it kind of all happens right there. And it's really taken off. Like I said, I'm still relatively small. I've been doing this show for about 2 years. And then Aaron came on my show three times now. Aaron is what I call a repeat offender.
Offender. Yeah.
Repeat offender. And she's like, hey, at some point, do you want me to try to get Andrea on? And I went, Andrea, who? And she's like, Andrea Perrin. So I kind of played it off like, oh, yeah, I know who she is. And then I went, I have no idea who she is. And I really didn't. I had no idea who you were. So it was kind of funny to do research and find out who you were. And I did about 2 pages of research. And then I decided I wanted to stop because they kept telling me the mythological storytelling actress side of you and not the real you. And I'm like, nah, that's enough of that. So then I reached out to Aaron and said, hey, about a year now, we've been talking about having Andrea come on. What do you think? And she's like, well, sure. Let's do this. Brings us to today.
Yeah.
Yep.
Well, you know, it was funny. I was really quite amused when you told me that you had to do research. And did you ever see the movie The Conjuring?
No, my wife and I still have not seen it.
No. Okay. Probably it's best that way.
It's on our bucket list. In fact, it was funny because she's like, you're going on her show and we still haven't seen The Conjuring. How are you going to tell her that we still haven't seen The Conjuring? I'm like this. I haven't seen The Conjuring.
Yeah. So you're one of like 6 people left on the planet who haven't. And
I hadn't seen it either when I met her. I had never seen the movie. Had no clue.
She had she had no idea who I was. Absolutely not. And that's, you know, for me, that's really great because I am exactly who I am all the time. I'm not the only acting I ever do is on a stage as another character. And I gave that up years ago after 25 years as a member of the theater company of Rhode Island. And I really enjoy just being myself. All the time and consistently, authentically, stupidly me. I'm very gullible. I'm very naive. I fall for every pretty face that walks in the door or that I pick up off the road. You know, I've got proof of that right behind me.
Right behind you. Yeah.
And it's refreshing not to have to meet somebody that has absolutely no preconceived notions.
Yeah.
Right.
No, I enjoy that. And that's when I met Aaron a couple of years ago, at a Strange Escapes, event with Amy Bruni and Adam Berry. And I had Peanut, my little peanut buttercup over there, right there. Peanut.
Over the shoulder. Yeah.
With me and my father up in St. Augustine. And I had seen her in the conference, you know, it was because she's tall and She's got long, beautiful hair, which I admired. And so I had seen her, but I hadn't really spoken with her. And we hadn't even had a face-to-face encounter, like, hi, how are you? Right. Because usually when I'm at these events, I've got a lot of people around me. And so if somebody is being a little bit of a wallflower or shy, well, she wasn't really being either of those. She just didn't know who I was or how I was attached to the event or anything until she heard me speak at my lecture. And when it was done, I believe we took Peanut out to go for a walk, and she was sitting in front of the resort on a metal bench. And I plopped down next to her and I introduced myself and told my father to take the dog. and I just turned and I looked at her straight in the face and I looked at her eyes and I said, I'm pretty sure you're connected with the Arcturians. And she said, I've been told that before. And that was it. That was it.
Yeah,
I mean, it was like instant connection. She understood exactly what I was saying. It was her first, what, am I right, Erin? It was your first paranormal event?
Yeah, ever.
Your first paranormal event ever. And and I fell in your lap. She's still trying to recover from that.
Right.
But, you know, and I said to you yesterday on the phone, Tom, we were supposed to meet. Okay. We were, you know, this was actually supposed to happen. We have an extraordinary amount. After I was reading your bio and I saw that your ancestry is Indigenous and you have Nordic in you, which I see. You got that Viking thing going on. My mother had, I guess, what was it, Erin? I told you like 2 or 3 years ago, I got her the 23andMe for Christmas.
Yeah,
and
she had a Nordic connection.
And we knew she was Scottish. We knew Clan Buchanan. We knew the English, the Isles family. We knew that. We knew that she had Cherokee and Creek Indian, which they really were the same tribe. Cherokee, North Georgia, the Creeks were more south and into Florida.
Yep.
She has Welsh, she has Irish, she has, you know, a number of different bloodlines, but we discovered when we did her ancestry that she's one of 9 living people on the planet that has the mitochondrial DNA of a mighty Viking queen.
Oh.
That was buried with, they just not that long ago discovered her tomb. And it was filled with riches and her horses and her, I mean, it's a major, huge tomb. All of her weapons, her everything was discovered by archaeologists. And my mother's got her DNA. So I do too, a drop or so.
Yeah.
Which explains why I'm such a mighty warrior for peace. And that's not counterintuitive, by the way. It's perfectly okay to be a spiritual warrior.
So is that guy.
Yeah, I know. So we talked and it was like, oh my God, we have so much in common.
Right.
It's amazing. It's amazing.
And it was like an instant connection too. It was really
It was. I'm like, oh my God, I love your voice. Oh geez, I feel like I know you. It's so weird. But you came upon your gifts and your abilities later in life, which often happens. My friend Chip Coffee didn't even discover that he was a medium until he, I believe he was in his 40s.
Yeah.
And, you know, he knew there was something different about him, but it just, the door opened. The eye opened and the door opened and boom. How did that happen for you?
It really happened on my first investigation. I was asked to come on an investigation with people that I was friends with, and they were already part of an investigation team. And they asked my wife and I to come on an investigation just to kind of check it out and to hang out with them and everything else. And it was a private investigation. It was an overnighter for a couple of nights. And we got to the location and we kind of set up and everything else, and we're kind of sitting in the living room, and all of a sudden this full person apparition walks in, and an older lady in a period piece, and she had a nice, wonderful long dress on and everything else. And she stopped and she looked at me and she said, "You can see me." And I go, "And I can hear you." And she went, "Okay." And like, it kind of threw her back, it threw her off a little bit. So she and I started having a conversation. And well, I was with another, two others, psychics and mediums. And they were like, "Who are you talking to?" And I'm like, "That lady right there." And they're like, "Well, we could see her. Why can you see her?" I'm like, "Cause she walked into the room and started talking to me." And they were like, "How long have you been able to do this?" And I literally went like 10 seconds. And that was my awakening right there. It was right at that point. Was when I realized I was able to do this. And then at that point, it just slugged me like, and I tell people, at that point, it flooded into me like I was drinking from a fire hose.
So, yeah. Yep. Pretty good description. Pretty right? accurate. And well, right.
I know you've had Erin on your show, and she's an energy worker, an energy healer. You know, we've talked about yesterday, we talked about light workers and star seeds and all the stuff. And you told me at that time that when I do your show, I can talk about anything that I want to talk about.
Yep.
Which is great. But, you know, and I'm really looking forward to it. I haven't been doing an awful lot of interviews because of my mom's situation here at home. And so, but I absolutely agreed to do your show, and really looking forward to it. Not quite sure what we're going to delve into, probably a little bit of everything, but what is it? About energy healing. You talked about multiple dimensions, and I spoke with you about, you know, the realization of oneness. Everything is one thing, how we're all connected in consciousness. And we talked about, you know, a prime creator. We talked about a lot.
We did
off a lot. 30 or 40 minutes.
Yeah.
But have you been at this long enough to develop a technique?
So I have what I would warrant, and don't laugh, Erin, because you're going to know what exactly I'm talking about. I have developed what is known as the lazy technique. I don't practice anything. It just kind of happens. It really does.
I practice that technique too.
Well, like, Tom, hold on. You have a very specific protection technique, which I find fascinating. So that's not entirely true.
Which one?
Your armor.
Oh, yes. So, well, that's my protection technique, but it just happens. It's just there. So what Erin's talking about is I have a protection.
Sorry, I just blew your cover.
Oh, no, you're fine. That's okay. My superhero identity. You're fine. So I have, I wear this armor on me, and it's funny because you can see behind me, my Superman stuff is all up on the wall. Well, I actually wear, my superhero outfit or my armor, and it literally is a golden armor, what I call my heaven armor, but my golden armor, and it's very impenetrable. So anything that wants to try to touch me or tries to affect me or anything else, it can't, because it can't penetrate through my armor. Mm-hmm. And I have allowed things to come in to touch me, but I only let it go so far, and then from then I just cut it off. But I've had stuff attempt to try to rip through it. In fact, I had to do a remote help with someone from the Paranormal Existence Research Society. And we were trying to remove something and it wouldn't come up out of the well. And we couldn't pull it out. I'm like, I'll just go grab it. So I just grabbed it and pulled it out and it starts striking my armor. And I just laughed at it. I'm like, oh, you're so cute. And then we just let it, you know, we got rid of it and it went away. But yeah, for the most part, though, my abilities, the only thing that I can kind of figure out is I've been doing them for so long through past lives that they're very natural to me now. So I don't have to practice them is basically how I feel and also what I've been told. They're just there on command. So that's why I just call it the lazy technique. I know there's other things I can probably strengthen or sharpen if I tried. But they just seem to show up when they want to, and then they just kind of stay with me. So it's kind of how they do.
Always evolving too.
Well, it is. It's a process, but You know, do you ever have a moment where you're a little bit fearful or that you wish that it never happened?
No. Anyone who knows me personally will tell you that I have absolutely zero fear. I always tell people I'm too dumb to know any better. Yeah. So I don't have any fear. But as soon as it happened, I could tell that there were times back in my life, in my past, where they were developing. I just wasn't paying attention to them. They were there. I just did not recognize them. But now that they've happened, I've completely accepted them. I've never said, I don't want this. There's never been a time to where I wish they hadn't happened. I'm very proud to have them, and I'm very honored to have them, because the way I'm using them, I feel, is the right way to use them. Because I'm not using them to benefit me. I'm using them to benefit others. And I think that's what's important to use them for. And luckily, my one and only mentor, and then the other people I've surrounded myself with, are very good at teaching me that and making sure I remember that and helping me remember that. So yeah, there's no reason for me to ever not want them.
Good.
Right.
That's wonderful to know, because I find people that struggle the most with newly discovered gifts resent that this major change has happened so quickly in their lives that it kind of upsets their apple cart. And my attitude has always been, go back and get a bigger cart.
Right.
You know, there's room for lots of varieties of apples, and the more you can learn. And you know, I don't know if what I came into this world knowing and experiencing came from a past life or came from another planet. I don't know. Well, I'm very comfortable with saying I don't know.
Right.
In answer to a question. I'm sure when I do your show, you'll hear it several times.
I say the same
thing. Don't know.
I say the same thing. If I don't know it, I'm not going to try to BS you on it. It's not my job. If you don't like the fact I don't know, then go find somebody that you're happy with that will lie to you.
Well, that will lie to you. Exactly. Because you know what? Nobody knows.
Right.
Nobody does. There are no experts in this field. You know, the paranormal is a journey for everyone that's in it.
Right.
It's a part, I think, of our spiritual ascension and our awareness, our self-awareness, but also our awareness of the cosmos and, you know, this extraordinary universe that we are all sharing. And it's the magic and the mystique and the mysteries of life, I think, maybe are supposed to remain mysteries.
Yeah.
Until we're done with the life. That's why I'm so fascinated with people who have had near-death experiences. My friend Lynn Ann Bowling, her husband Jeff, has had a couple of near-death experiences that have broadened his horizons in ways that he thinks differently. Now, he openly admits that you know, coming that close to death, seeing the other side, and then being gifted with a return to this life completely alters the perspective of the person who undergoes that transition. And so they're the ones, I think, NDE people are the ones that probably, if there's anybody in this field that has anything to teach us, it's probably them.
Yeah.
It's probably them. And the rest of us are just flying by the seat of our pants. We just don't know.
I would agree with that.
Yeah.
Well, you know, one of these days, you're going to pick up my books and you're going to read a story that will curl your beard. and after that happens, and when you are properly prepared and enticed, will make arrangements for you to go and experience the farm. Aaron, talk about experiencing the farm.
Where do I start?
No.
I'm in love with this farm already simply because Aaron shares so much with it. Sorry, Aaron, I didn't mean to cut you off, but.
No, you're good.
Don't worry about it. I do it all the time.
I did show Andrea yesterday, and you knew this already, Aaron, that I pick up energies through pictures and through videos and just from seeing you. Mm-hmm. And I can tell if you're a good person or if you're someone who I'm just like, nope, not today. And I do the same thing with the properties and the home and everything else. And there is such a familiarity to it, to me, for some reason. I feel like I've been here before, even though I've never honestly been to it, at least in this lifetime. But there's such a comfortableness to it. It's very homey to me. It's very relaxing to me, even through images. And now I get to share them through Britt Isley and through Michelle Royce as well. So I get to see them there. So now I get a plethora of the pictures. Oh, I got to use a big word today. The plethora of pictures today, where I get to just enjoy it through all of you. And the descriptions you give, it's very odd because a lot of times I'll see it and I'll get a recognition of it. And then you'll say it. And I'm like, oh, that's exactly what I was feeling. Mm-hmm. So it's like there's a connection through it somehow. And it's really cool to get to experience that way. But I would like to experience it up close. So.
Well, what's interesting, Andrea, I think we've talked about this before, is that Tom very much has a tie with elementals.
Very much.
And obviously we've all discussed experiences we've had on the property with the potential of elementals. I mean, I know there's one that presents to me often. He looks like a giant Groot, but he's not a cartoony, but that's similar, you know, huge tree. So yeah. I think for Tom too, that tie for you, there's not a lot of people who are, well, Brittany is. Specifically drawn to, she's got a draw to elementals as well. So
yep.
How does that kind of look for you too when you're exploring an elemental type situation? Like, what's your draw for that?
As far as what do I feel? What do I see? What do I hear?
Any of it. Like, what's your draw to them, or did they come to you? How do you know? Is it something of us are more aligned with certain things, and you seem to go that way with the elementals?
It's really my culture. I'm not only Indigenous as we spoke, but I'm also Norse, and both sides are very much tied to the earth. Yes. And I believe that's where my strong attachment is to elementals, because I am one of the few who can see, hear, and talk to elementals just like I'm talking to both of you ladies right now. They come to me just like they're a regular person. They talk to me like a regular person, but it's very frustrating because they do not have the normal feelings of a human. You know, their purpose is literally to do what they're sent here to do, heal the earth, take care of the wind, cleanse areas with fire, and to protect with water. And they come to me and they say, I'm here. This is what I'm doing. And it's like, I can't question them or anything else because they're like, this is just what I'm doing. But I've had a couple of conversations with them to where they've assisted me. I think it is because of my tie to them that they're willing that we both have that understanding that we're both of Earth. And so they, you know, for the better part of saying it, we're both from Earth. So they, people need to understand that elementals are not aliens. They are actually from the environment themselves. It is not an alien thing. It's an environmental thing. And that's how they come about. So I think that's my strong attachment to them, is because I'm so strong in both my Norse and my Indigenous backgrounds that we're just part of each other is the best way to say it.
Yeah.
Well, I think that my experience at the farm itself, it's not just the house.
Right.
It's the property.
Yeah, I was going to say it's the property.
And the experiences that I've had there. I mean, there is a river. It's the Lost River of New Hampshire that was buried during the last ice age. And it runs directly under the farm. And you can go lay on the stone walls and you can feel the vibration of the water that's 700 feet down. It was a 700 foot well we had to dig before we hit it. Wow. And when we did, the pressure was so much that it blew apart all the rigging for the well diggers. It shattered the gauge and all the equipment. Everything just got blown apart. It was a geyser. It was like, you know, had it been oil, right. I'd be on a beach in Tahiti. But you can literally feel the vibration of the planet there. And one of our mutual friends, Julie DeMay, took a flir picture of the farm one time, and it looked like it was ablaze. Yeah. I mean, it was absolutely amazing, the energy that's coming off of that place. And it's not just spirit, it's elemental energy. Yeah. It's extraterrestrial energy. It's, you know, we learned really quickly moving into that house. And when we bought the house in 1970, moved in on January 11th of 1971. And we learned, you know, very quickly that we were occupying shared space.
Yeah.
And that as big as the house was, it was really crowded. And so I think I was the first one who saw a full body apparition in the house, but he appeared perfectly flesh and blood to me. I thought he was dressed rather oddly, but as I walked past him, I said, "Good morning, sir." It never occurred to me that he was a ghost. Yeah. But my sister Nancy saw him like evaporate in front of her eyes a few minutes later when she was walking through the house, and she saw him too. And four of the five of us, of the children, saw him within the first 5 or 10 minutes that we lived in the house. And we were off to the races. I mean, that's why I asked you about, you know, when you had your awakening, when you had your awareness that you'd been gifted and were unaware until that moment. If you had any fear about it, because we didn't. He wasn't threatening in the least. This was just, but we were little kids.
Right.
And, you know, it was just something really new and different. And, you know, kind of like Dorothy, we knew we weren't in Kansas anymore. You know, a lot of people who are older, who stumble upon, for whatever reason, that door finally opens for them, really struggle with it. And it's very refreshing to see that you don't struggle and that you embrace it.
Yeah, I'm that firm believer that if it happened to me, then there's a reason for it. To me, nothing is accidental. So if you're going to give me these gifts to use, then by all means, allow me to use them. You know, I'm not going to shy away from them. I'm not a shy, quiet person, if you haven't been able to tell.
No, I kind of picked up on that vibe. Yeah.
So I'm not going to run away from anything like this. If they're going to hand it to me, I'm going to use it to the best of my ability. So, well, outside of being a lazy person, but yeah, for the most part, I'll use it to the best of my ability.
Well, but I wonder for you. Oops, sorry.
No, that's okay. Go ahead.
I was just wondering too. I think I wonder for you, because you do have the background of the indigenous side, but then you also have the Norse side. Those two huge parts of you are both based in element and nature and earth, right, and connection and groundedness. So I'm all, you know, and then you tie in your elemental side. It almost makes sense to me that it comes naturally to you, that it wasn't quite the struggle that it can be. Like, I spent 6 months basically, and I say this sort of sarcastically, but not entirely, like rocking in the fetal position in the corner, like, oh God, make it stop. But I didn't understand the connection to the earth and the, like, I didn't know any of that. Like, it wasn't an innate thing to me at that time. Whereas for you, I'm curious, do you feel like, two-part question, that that's a natural thing and maybe that helped you make things easier? And then in a place like the farmhouse, the fact that you do have that Indigenous tie, as does the property, because our friend Carrie also has Indigenous blood, also very drawn to the land, especially over the bridge. So do you feel like that connection to the elements for you kind of helps both of those things?
So for the first
question, sorry.
Yeah, that's okay. But for the first part, I think, well, so obviously no one here knows what my background is, except for probably you, Aaron, as far as my military background. And I was always on foot. Everything I did, I laid in the grass. I went across the water. I did everything. Everything I did when I was military was attached to Earth. We didn't fly places. We ran places. We walked places. We crawled through places. We did everything like that. But even growing up, I was always doing something. Dirt eater, swimmer, you know, everything else like that. That was me. Bug eater, all that wonderful stuff. I was always doing something that had to do with the land. I just grew up that way. And, you know, I always had to have my, even now, I live in Nebraska, and people think I'm nuts because it's freezing out here, but I still have to be barefoot, and I can walk outside barefoot because my feet have to be touching the ground. And I'm always that way. And it's just natural. And I think with the house, I think it's a combination of, and like you said, Andrea, it's the property, but there's also a very, yes, to your question, Aaron, the elemental part of the property is very much drawn to me. Like I could, yeah, I know. Sorry, but
here we go, y'all.
I know, I saw it.
Your property with the water underneath it, with the river underneath it, will react differently when I show up. It just will. Mm-hmm. It'll hum totally different when I get there. And the wind will act differently when I get there. I don't mean that to sound braggadocious or anything else, but whenever I've gone places, like I went out to Hawaii with a couple of friends and they went to places with me and they're from there. And even they said, we have never experienced this before. What is this? And I go, oh, these are the wind elementals, guarding us as we walk through. And they're like, we've never had a wind like this before. This is incredible. And they're like, well, I'm like, well, wait till we get to the water. And as soon as we got to the water, the wind stopped. And they basically said, we're handing you off to the water elementals. We're done protecting you. Now it's the water elementals' turn. And all of a sudden, the water was just stream, but it picked up so much speed and so much strength. And they were like, what is this? And I'm like, this is our water elementals taking care of us. So it seems to happen when I'm amped up in energy. And it seems that they seem to want to talk. They want to show off in a way to others to say, hey, I'm here. Let us show you what we can do type of thing. So it's pretty cool. And I think that has a lot of it to do with the property as well, is because I'm anxious to get there because I have that feeling of what's going to happen when I'm there. And I think it's going to be something different compared to what has happened before.
They're going to have a field day with you. So you talk about the wind. Andrew, I know, has experienced as well. Like, I always try to be very cognizant of all the spirit on the property. And, you know, like I'll be camping the first couple nights, and I'm not going to lie, that scared the hell out of me. I mean, like, that's a whole other show. But after the first couple nights, I just set out to the, you know, thank you so much for keeping me safe. And there's not a lot of wind normally up there in Rhode Island, unless there's a storm or something. And literally just in front of me, probably within like 100 foot sort of radius, this wind just out of nowhere, just in this one spot where I was standing, just starts. I think I called Andrew as soon as it was done. And that was when it dawned on me for the first time that the elements are paying attention to you too when you're there. And that doesn't happen everywhere. Yeah. And then, of course, you take somebody like you to come onto a place like that.
Yeah.
Pardon my language, but holy shit. I will make sure I'm there that week.
Well, we've all had experiences with vortex. Wind events on the farm. Yeah. You have one of the spirits from they all know that we're talking about them. They're you know, free to fly. One of them is with you right now. I think I know who. No, I'm not going to mention any names, but I'm pretty sure she's there with you right now. Definitely female energy, no question about it. I've kind of been watching her peeking in and out, you know, I'm I'd be curious to know if any of the viewers picked up on that. If any of our viewers saw that female entity that's with you. And she didn't show up until we started talking about the farm.
Yeah.
And we know who she is. And we are entering a new age with her. We have chosen to kind of keep her identity. And Tom knows this too. Actually, I did Tom's show after my 3-week stint up there last summer.
Yep.
And he was very respectful with me trying to still process some of the things that have been going on. But I think it's interesting that we're talking about this. She never pops up on shows ever. And she is, I think, having her eyes opened a bit as well. So I do find it interesting that it sounded like my fridge was getting jostled like this. That's why I kept looking over. It's just right there. But I think she's in the guest room. So I do find it interesting that we're having this discussion and she's like, in like an excited way. So I think that bodes to Tom's energy too, because she doesn't really love men a whole lot currently. So I think that's testament to Tom's energy.
It's funny because a lot of people, especially kids, it's amazing how well kids will look at me and they'll just stare. It doesn't matter where we're at. People have seen it all over the place. We'll just be in a store and all of a sudden the kid will just, not even paying attention to anything else, all of a sudden they'll stop and they'll stare at me. Mm-hmm. And then they'll smile and they'll wave. And it's so many kids. But the parents react.
That's your extraterrestrial connection too.
Yeah.
That was my question for you. Because exactly the same thing happens to me. Children particularly.
Yeah. They do it all the time. They stop. It seems like whenever I'm walking by somebody, like if I'm walking by a gentleman or I'm walking by a couple or whatever else, I won't even be paying attention to them. I'm not staring at them or anything else. But when it seems like when a guy walks by me, they're like, "Hey," like they always are the first ones to interact with me. And I'm always nice enough and respectful to say hi back. But I'm never expecting it. But it happens all the time, and we don't know what it is. But Nikki's like, "Did you know that person?" I'm like, "No." I'm like, "What this out of you?" I'm like, "I don't know." So.
Oh, no.
So it just happens. No,
you put off everything is vibration, everything is energy, and you know, we resonate with each other in the same way that you and I did, the same way when I met Aaron, and countless other people that have come through my life that I might have only encountered that one time.
Right.
But it left an impact and made an impression, and there was a connection that happened, and we don't know what it is, but for me, I think that's that part of us. Well, you said to me yesterday after we had only talked for a few minutes, and out of the blue, you said to me, "Are you a hybrid?"
Yep.
No, and I think that a lot of us that are in this field that have gravitated in an almost magnetic way to the paranormal have an extraterrestrial connection. Mm-hmm. I don't for a moment think that we're not here with purpose and reason at this time of a time of urgency and crisis for the planet, and a time when technology is exploding. And there's a part of us that knows where all of that comes from, and that we were gifted with it. You know, it wasn't just an overnight miracle that we went from, you know, burning whale oil 150 years ago for light to traveling around the solar system now. That was, there's a connection, and I want to know, when you are drawn to it and fascinated by it, and what do you feel that your extraterrestrial connection is?
Oh my. I have been that kid. I can say that long ago, I've always been that kid that always looked up and said, that's me. That's me. It's always been that way. And it carried on through my entire life. I mean, my degree is in quantum mathematics and theoretical statistics. So even in that realm, it went through where I can take all that information and push it into the universe and try to do statistics with it, and then also carry a lot of the physics background. And I was very much interested in voids and dark matter, and you know, is it fractal, or is it wave, or what is it that creates what we're around, and is it a combination of the two? And so it's just been kind of like my entire growing up. It is. And even now, Nikki and I were lucky enough to move out onto a lake that's very quiet and not a whole lot of lights around us at all. So at night, when it gets dark, we go outside and we look up at the stars. I'm still just very drawn to it, very much. It just happens to be what I can say consciously and subconsciously, I've always had that pull. As far as anything else, I don't know. I mean, I fully believe. I actually had a starseed reading done. I believe it's pretty accurate. But because when I read through a lot of it was an aha moment. You know, it was like, oh, well, that makes a lot of sense to me. That really resonates with me. And I didn't do it until a year ago. So it's not like I read it when I was 10 and now I've just kind of developed it off of what I read. No, I've already lived it all. And now it's telling me what I've already lived. Mm-hmm. So it's interesting to see it that way.
Well, I know an awful lot of people that have military background mm-hmm. that gravitate to the paranormal. Mm-hmm. And I've wondered what that connection is. I also know that I have a number of friends who are contactees who from a very early age decided that they needed to go into the Air Force and be a pilot.
Yeah.
And it always, that urgency, that feeling of I need to do this. This is what I'm supposed to do. Generally came after their first contact.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think my, I don't know if I've ever been contacted. I couldn't tell you if I ever have, but I can tell you that I believe that whatever part of me is attached to whatever region I'm from out in the universe has always been a protector, because I've been a protector my entire life. Mm-hmm. Even my military, that's what I did. I protected people. And so that's been something I believe I've done through not only this life, but numerous other lives, and in not only human lives, but other starseed lives as well. But I've always been a protector. And I think that's why I'm good at it now, because I've had so much practice from the past.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's fascinating to me.
Yeah, it is.
I love that.
I need to introduce you to my friend Rupert, who is, I guess, for lack of a better phrase, is space scientist, rocket scientist. He should be working at NASA, but he'd probably freak them out completely, because I know he's not from here. I know he's not from here. Like, you know,
yeah,
on the Earth, but not of the Earth. Yeah,
right.
He's an amazing, amazing man. So what we'll do is what I'll do is I'll connect you with him so that you can be on his show that he does here on KGRA, and then have you both on together to talk about. Of course, I'll feel like the dumb kid on the block, you know, because I only have 2 degrees and they're in philosophy and English literature. So you're the scientists, and I'll just sit there with my mouth hanging open and listen to your discussion. And what did I tell you? What was the last thing that I told you, Tom, before we hopped off the phone yesterday?
Oh my goodness.
Maybe how fast an hour can go.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. True.
Yeah.
And okay. Yeah. We talked about how fast my hours go on my shows, huh, Aaron?
Yeah.
So
yeah. They go fast.
They go very fast. Yep.
Well, we're down to about 3 minutes. And so I want to thank both of you. Aaron, thank you for hopping in at the last conceivable moment.
Of course.
And I know she's just like, I have several assisters Lenny, Aaron, Greta. Yeah, like, and I circle my wagons and feel very, very protected and loved by my my tribe, as it were. But you have now been sucked into our family. And so
I'm somebody again. Yay. No.
You always were.
Thank you.
And I very much appreciate Aaron introducing us, and I very much appreciate you moving mountains to get here tonight and come on the show.
Thank you.
And we'll connect on Facebook. Are we connected on Facebook? You know, it is the official home of the paranormal.
Yeah, we're not connected on Facebook.
Okay, I'll kick one of my cousins to the curb and make room for you. They're used to it. They know their placeholders. And we'll get you on so that we can advertise, you know, do a promo for our upcoming show together in March.
Perfect.
And I will join you then, and we'll just pick up where we left off. But I very much appreciate both of you being with me this evening. And I will just end the broadcast tonight and hang around afterwards. I'll talk to you after we're off. But I will end the broadcast tonight the way that I always do, except please, if you would take a moment to say a prayer for the Navalny family. I would appreciate that personally. And remember to be the change that you wish to see in the world, and always be the beacon and be the light you seek. Thank you all for joining us tonight. Good night.